Hidden in the state park of eastern central Florida's Flagler Beach lie the mysterious ruins of a cultural artifact that dates to the 19th century. At its height, the Bulow Plantation covered more than 2,000 acres and produced crops such as cotton and sugarcane.
The Bulows showed up in July of 1821 when the United States was taking over Florida. We think they brought down a construction team from their plantation up north. And we think there were close to 300 slaves building this plantation. The Bulow Sr. was only alive here for 3 short years. We believe he died of yellow fever in St. Augustine. His son, who was only 16 years old, came over from Paris, France. The manager here was Mr. Francesco Pellissier.
My name is James Fisk. I'm the president of the Bulow Parks Historic Alliance Incorporated. Every now and then we do presentations out here. I'm Francisco Pedro Pellissier. I was born up in St. Augustine. He was the head honcho of everything, but they would have to have some slaves that would really take over duties and make sure that the others did what needed to be done.
There were only 2 Caucasians on the plantation. Therefore, the management were slaves too. And these were very skilled people. They had to be steam engine operators. They had to be chemists to make the sugar. They had to be quarrymen. There was a coquina mine near here. Those stones had to be pre-cut to fit. When you look at the construction of those stones and you reflect that it was done by slave labor, it's absolutely amazing. The locals believed for a long time that this was built by the Spanish as a mission. Of course, it wasn't.
These are the typical ruins left behind by the slave quarters. You can usually tell that it's a man-made feature because the rocks will be manipulated. We also have a nice insight as to this being the slave quarter because we've had some excavations done by a field school from University of Florida. And we're looking for artifacts, jewelry, tools, things like that, that will just give us a little bit of insight to what life may have been like nearly 200 years ago.
Rising demand for sugar generated tremendous profits for young Bulow.
We're here at the sugar house. This is the place where the juice from the sugar cane would be brought to be refined into crystalline sugar and molasses. Behind me are the sugar kettles where the process would begin to refine the sugar. Once that process starts and the liquid is heated up, it would form into crystalline sugar. Once that happened, the sugar would be scooped and laid onto cooling vats where it would be dried and stored for later use.
It was making about $20,000 a year profit, and that's big money back in 1830. Accounts said that Mr. Bulow had a wonderful wine collection. He had one of the finest libraries in the United States. The plantation house was quite large. It was actually 3 stories. It had central heating. I think they lived well. So he would have visitors from all over the world.
In 1831, one of Bulow's guests was naturalist and wildlife painter John James Audubon, who, probably in gratitude, fashioned a portrait featuring the plantation in the background. The Seminole Indians burned the plantation in January of 1836 during the Second Seminole War. To this day, evidence of the massive fire lingers on the crumbling coquina stone.
The burning was simple. Bulow, number one, wasn't here anymore. The army had fortified it, built a big fort. The Indians burned any place that had been fortified. As a matter of fact, some of the plantations that weren't fortified initially were not burned or attacked.
The Bulow Plantation State Park has inspired a passionate group of local volunteers to help preserve and promote the historic ruins.
What we try to do is provide fundraising for the park to try to do preservation. One of our projects was putting mulch onto the quarter mile trail that runs from the pavilion here to the ruins. We need to keep the natural look in those as much as possible. So far, we've had a couple reenactments out here with people dressed as Seminole and the military as well.
The history of Florida has almost vanished. The developers bulldoze, roads get moved. You have Mickey Mouse, and you have pirates and ghosts up in St. Augustine. Right here is the heart of Florida.
There's a very, very important story to tell here, and it's a romantic story. It's a heartbreaking story. I get very passionate about trying to convey some of these stories to our younger generation so that they can be able to tell their children later on in life about this place, because who knows, this may not be there then.